Hey gang legends, fellow fitness professionals and committed trainers who want to lift and do some strength training to improve your physique, your health, your quality of life. So welcome back to the series of exercises, evaluation of exercise, to evaluate their effectiveness and their safety. And today we're going to apply those five steps to another very common exercise for the shoulders, the shoulder press. Yes, again, most of these exercises I have done when I was a young buck. Yes, I was. I used to be an up and coming bodybuilder where I was completely ignorant, but driven by emotion and driven by passion just to lift everything. The more I lifted, the bigger I got, and that was my goal. So let's have a look at the shoulder press. And there's many ways to do the shoulder press, but essentially it's all pretty well up on the up and up. Let's have a look at why people do a shoulder press. And again, the main reason why people do the shoulder press is because they're trying to target the deltoids. Now, whether that is to get width or to get mass or get tone or get striations or get shape, understanding a lot of those terms that you share when it comes to the benefit are really just airy-fairy words that really mean much. You know, shape. Well, what is shape? Well, your muscles have their own shape based on your genetics. It's called the elasticity properties of muscle. They're always returning to the resting shape and length. So you can't really change the shape of a muscle, but you can change the appearance by putting on a bit of muscle in those areas, and it will grow according to your genetic potential and your genetic, template. And you can also lose the fat to make it look more defined. You're not changing, you're just showing it off a bit more by removing a little bit of the doona cover on top of it. So also when you come across terms such as toning and shaping and firming, really they're just airy-fairy words. What they really basically mean is get rid of the fat, put as much muscle as you possibly can in the area and show off your genetic potential. So let's have a look why people do it. Yes, they do it for the shoulders. The next question, number two, is it safe? So let's have a look at the shoulder press. And there's many ways to do a shoulder press. So basically it's taking a weight. You can be pushing up from in front. You either use a straight bar or dumbbells or an easy bar. I picked the easy bar because I thought it might be easy to lift. And you push up, and you gotta be careful not to take your nose off, and pushing up and then back down. Sometimes people will actually go up behind their head. That's how I used to do it back in the old days. Used to get the bar behind my head and I pressed the weight up like so. So that is the shoulder press, or some people do it with dumbbells or single dumbbells. So let's have a look at the movement pattern from a safety point of view. And as I shared with you previously, when you look at an exercise, look at any exercise from the inside out, not the outside in. So when you look at the movements, I want you to strip me of all my body fat, see how lean I am, strip me of all my skin, strip me of all my muscle, and just imagine that I'm a skeleton. Herbie. Herbie, you might be somewhere around here. Herbie, you here? Okay, he's coming. So take everything off and look at what is it doing to the skeletal system, the joints, the cartilage, the ligaments, and then you're going to see if there's some safety challenges. Because muscles, you know, it's very hard to tear muscles doing weight training, but you can wear, very hard to tear muscles, easy to wear tendons and degenerate joints. And that's what we don't want, because your joints are very hard to recover and regenerate, particularly later on in life. Muscles respond quite well even later on in life, but joints do not. We don't tend to have muscle replacements, we tend to have joint replacements, as you probably know if you have a grandpa or mum and dad who are having some challenges. So let's have a look at the movement pattern. Go back to the anatomical position. What we're doing in this position is we're taking the arm into abduction, shoulder abduction, away from the midline, and then we are laterally rotating the shoulder joint. And then I'm putting a weight in my hand, whether it be slightly in front, where my shoulder goes into a slightly horizontal flex position, or I take it behind my back in a horizontally extended position with more lateral rotation, and then I'm pressing the weight above my head with the target of isolating the deltoids. The challenge, as you can probably imagine, with this position, is if I wanted to dislocate your shoulder joint, well, that would be the perfect position to do it. I'd take your arm into a shoulder abduction and I'd laterally rotate it. This is what we call the most unstable position you can put your shoulder joint in, and this is how you can dislocate it. Now, I know that from personal experience. I remember I was on the bench one time doing pullovers and I lost a bit of the control of the weight and I subluxed my shoulder joint, which means I partially dislocated. I dropped the weight, I put it in, I was sort of felt nauseous when it happened. And I thought, well, why did that happen? Is that because my shoulder's in a very unstable position? I also remember I was training an Olympic kayaker. It was only 8 weeks out from the Barcelona Olympics. and we were doing some shoulder presses above head, and we were also doing some overhead tricep stuff, and he lost control and he partially dislocated his shoulder joint. And that really made me sick. I thought, my gosh, I felt that I've stolen his Olympic dream away from his last Olympics. And fortunate for me, we rehabilitated him, he ended up winning a silver medal in the Olympics. So that was fortunate. Maybe he could have got a gold, I don't know, but he certainly did very well, better than what he'd imagined. But he almost, if it was probably another centimetre more, he may not have competed at all due to the silly exercise prescription that I gave him to try to work his deltoids and his triceps, because I put his shoulder in a very unstable position. It's also, when you anything above your head is increasing the chances of impingement of your rotator cuff, and particularly when you're in the lateral rotated, you're going to put your long header bicep underneath the acromion process. So the two main tendons in the shoulder joint that are, how can you say, exposed to degeneration and tendonitis will be your supraspinatus, which is one of your four rotator cuff muscles, and your long header bicep, because both of them run underneath the acromion process. Therefore, you have a greater potential to impinge those tendons when you take your arms above your head, because your humerus can only go to 80 to 90 degrees of shoulder abduction. If I go any higher than that, my scapula or my shoulder blade has to laterally rotate. But for it to rotate, I'll tend to be impinging that tendon. Now, the body's designed to do that anyway, but not in a repetitive way with a heavy load. Because what you know is you're exaggerating those stresses going through that joint, going through those tendons, the impinged by to those two articulating surfaces, or to the two bony surfaces being the acromion process, that lump there, and your humerus, the head of the humerus, which is your bone in your arm. And every time you go above, that tendon has been impinged between those two bones, and over time it can wear and tear. Before you know it, without warning, you start to get this pain sensation, and you've already got degeneration of the tendon in your supraspinatus. So this position up here, shoulder press, from a safety point of view, is very hard for me with integrity to recommend for you to do to develop your deltoids, while it has the potential to degenerate your shoulder joint and your rotator cuff and your tendons in a repetitive way over a long period of time, and as well as put yourself in that unstable, safe position, particularly when you take it behind your head. Now, you could, if you wanted to, make it a little bit safer by using dumbbells. Instead of pressing up, maybe press a little bit in front, so you're taking your arm from going from abduction, and you're bringing it more into more shoulder flexion, because now you're taking away from that impingement position and also away from that dislocation position by bringing it slightly in front. It's not going to be a strong movement pattern, and you're not going to be able to lift this heavier weight, so therefore it's sort of compromised, it's sort of contradictory anyway. But yeah, some people may, if you're going to do, say, in a circuit class or something, then you're better off pushing some lighter weights out here rather than trying to lift heavy weights there, because that's going to have possibly a heavy consequence. But I'd even suggest, why'd you do that when I can get you to do other things which is going to be a lot safer? Why pick get an unsafe exercise and make it an unsafe exercise safer? Why don't you just pick a safe exercise and make it more effective? See, that doesn't make a lot of sense. Or if we do this, will that make it safer? As I shared before, that's like making smoking safer. It's still smoking. You're just not drawing back as much. It's probably a little bit safer, or bum puffing, or what it might be. You're still going in the wrong direction, maybe in a more cautious way. So one, the goal, deltoids with shape, size, all that stuff that people throw out there. But really, ultimately, you can either put on muscle and lose fat, and that's basically what you've got. And then your genetic potential will be displayed through your skin or hidden underneath the doona cover, which is the little subcutaneous level of a layer of fat. Is it safe? If I look at shoulder press, I'd probably give it probably around about a 5. If you go behind the head, I'd give it probably a 3 out of 10. Even a 2, depending how you do it. If in front, I'd probably give it a 4 to a 5, but again, I wouldn't rank it in the top half of good, safe exercises from a safety point of view. Is there a benefit? Well, certainly there's a benefit. That does work the deltoids. There's no doubt about it. It does work the deltoids. The challenge is you're working those muscles while compromising your joints, and once you compromise your joints, you will no longer be able to work the muscles, because the joints have to work for you to work the muscles. So be very careful. It may backfire down the track if you're going for those short-term gains. But then you go down to the next question. Yeah, there is a benefit. Understand it doesn't burn fat off your deltoids. Don't think you're going to get greater striations, because it's an anaerobic exercise using the lactate energy system So you're not going to be burning fat in upright rows or any isolated deltoid work. I'm sure I don't have to go down that path to explain that you don't burn fat lifting weights, specifically in the area that you're lifting. Some people feel that or think that, but we'll talk more about that in another session. The next question, is there a better exercise, a better, safer, more effective exercise? And this has a very strong yes to it. Again, as I share with the other deltoid exercises, which I've looked at from an effectiveness point of view and a safety point of view, any shoulder movement will work your deltoid. So the idea is what you want to do with your shoulder is put it in a strong movement pattern where you can lift a strong weight where you get a strong result. Don't put it in a weak movement pattern where you lift a weak weight to get a weak result, whether it be weak, 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 weak. Where your strong movements, such as any pushing movements like bench presses, dumbbell presses, push-ups, dips, or rowing, or chin-ups, they're all strong movements, and they involve the movement of your glenohumeral joint, either into an extension, into a bit more horizontal extension, into flexion, into horizontal flexion, or horizontal flexion, either into, this is going into flexion. All those movements are strong movements, because what you're putting is you're putting your shoulder in that strong position where it's not laterally rotated, and it's not medially rotated, it's not a long lever, it's shorter levers. You're putting compression or traction forces through the movement, so you're in a strong position, there's no impingement because your arm's away from shoulder abduction, and it's away from medial rotation. So you say bench presses and rows, you're lifting good weight. But all that weight, all that force generated through that exercise, yes, it goes through your pecs, pectoralis major, your latissimus dorsi, but it has to go through your deltoids first. So you get greater force going through the shoulder joint doing a bench press than you would doing a shoulder press. Because what weight do you lift when you do a shoulder press? It would be a lot lighter than the weight you lift with a bench press. So think of it, look at this arm, look what it's doing. Rather than going here, it's going here. It's still the same joint, it's just moving in a different plane, which means it's still the same joint, therefore it's still the same muscles, but it's a stronger movement plane. So a stronger movement plane. Therefore, why would you pick a weaker plane to move or to work the deltoids when you pick a stronger plane to work the deltoids and the pecs and all the other associated muscles? So don't put your joints in a weak position where, because it's weak and compromising and unsafe, you lift a weak weight to get a weak result. And not only will it be a weak result, it can be a result where it degenerates the joint while working the muscles, or degenerates the tendon while it's working the muscles. Because once your tendons are degenerated and your joints are degenerated, you will not be able to have the ability to work the muscles anyway, because you won't be able to move the joints. So is there a better exercise? Of course there is. Train the body as a whole, try not to isolate joints, because when you try to isolate joints, you actually isolate the stresses that go across those joints, and you put them in unsafe, unstable, compromising positions with a load, and you lift repetitively, wearing, tearing the joint. And that's not what I want. People don't come to you and say, hey, I want an exercise, a strength training program, and one of my goals is for you to give me an exercise that's going to promote shoulder degeneration, shoulder impingement, tendonitis, tendinopathy, osteoarthritis, rheumatoid arthritis, capsulitis. Can you please provide synovitis? Can you please provide all of them in an exercise? So, sure, let's do some of these exercises because they're going to isolate that joint. Yes, and you will work the muscle, but you're still going to have some major challenges with the joint. So take all that into consideration when you pick your next exercise. Now, I did talk about the benefit and the better. The point that I did miss was, is it functional? And some people say, well, isn't shoulder press functional? You know, don't you put things up in a shelf? Yes, you do put things up in a shelf. If I put my pillow up in the shelf or my bed sheets, I pick it up, I have my elbows in here, I don't put it behind my head, and I lift it up and I put it in the shelf this way. And last time I checked, my pillow didn't weigh 30 kilograms. My pillow's fairly light. So yes, you do these movements when you lift things up, but you don't do it on a repetitive way, and you don't do it with very heavy lifts or heavy weight. And if you do have to do it with a heavy weight, you don't push it this way. You actually tend to push it with your elbows in, and you try to push it that way. So if you say it's a functional exercise, I think you're really trying to stretch the point, because I don't see people walking around lifting weights above their head, heavy weights above their head on a repetitive nature. Occasionally you may have to reach or put something up, but how often do you do that? and how often is not very often, and you generally have the strength to be able to do it once or twice. So why would you train for it with a heavy load, which you never have to lift that heavy load, still in a joint position which isn't really functional, because you don't really lift that weight anyway. And you know, the most you're going to have probably lift is maybe a box, as in my cupboard, I might have to take a box out, but I don't pull it behind my head. So function, overall, if I had to rate the exercise, I wouldn't give it much more than any more than a 5, and less than a 5 if it's executed in an unsafe way, such as behind the head, maybe sometimes unsafe if you do it more often, more repetitive with really heavy weights, and you start cheating movements. So now you're going to have some major challenges. So look after your joints, because you don't look after your joints, you will not be able to work your muscles in the future. Lift safe.